The Zen Mindset. Here we discuss the various attitudes of mind that, when cultivated and maintained over time, are conducive to realizing your Zen nature. This experience is called Satori or Kensho, the seeing into one's true nature. There are as many paths to enlightenment as there are unique individuals in the world. No two paths the same. We find our own way and travel at our own pace. There is no precise roadmap to tell us which way when approaching a fork. Instead, there are a set of attitudes. Adopt these diligently, and wait patiently. It is not possible to say how long it will take, but one day, sooner or later, there will be a flash of insight into your true nature, a perfect moment of Satori, the first of many such glimpses of your true nature. You will remember and treasure that moment for the rest of your life. As you consolidate the mindset, the periods of Satori will extend from glimpses to something longer and more abiding. Experience life fully, vividly, selflessly. Enter wholeheartedly and without resistance into the whatever experiences come your way. Reduce your resistance to what happens down to something approaching zero. Cultivate a mindset of simply not minding what happens, trusting that what does happen is being served up by life as a necessary lesson in that moment. This particularly applies to the less desirable experiences that come our way. Try to embrace the reality of the situation without getting mad and complaining. If you do not learn the lesson in that instance, life simply serves up the same lesson again later in an altered form. And life will continue to serve up that experience until you finally grasp the meaning and take it to heart. Embrace the moment, allow it to have its place, then move on and leave it behind once and for all. This requires you to be mindful, fully conscious in the present moment and fully accepting of the circumstances of that moment. Obviously, this is much easier said than done, but this uncomfortable fact is that this very practice is the essence of spiritual growth, being willing to accept discomfort and make sacrifices for the sake of growth. Most of the time, people impose their judgment on situations, deciding them to be either good or bad. It is the product of a habitually judgmental mindset that is compelled to divide the world and everything in it into good and bad categories. Once we apply the label good or bad, we can no longer see the subtle meaning that lies beneath surface appearance. By using the higher brain function of metacognition, you can cultivate a mindset in which you observe the world of phenomena in a judgment-free way, accepting it without resistance, understanding that such resistance is what prevents you from experiencing every moment fully, vividly, selflessly. Next, choice between safety and risk. It is a fundamental feature of being alive that you are presented with ongoing choices. Reflect on the criteria used to decide, and you might notice it is often down to a choice between safety, from fear, and risk, for growth. For many, it is easy to fall into the habit of allowing safety to take precedence over risk. But we do not grow as a person unless we take risks. To deliberately make the growth choice as often as it is reasonably safe to do so. If the benefits outweigh the downside, then it is in your long-term interests to make the growth choice. What is the worst that can happen? How likely is it to happen? How would I cope if it did happen? If there is much to gain and little to lose, the choice is clear. In that instance, your inner naysayer voice can be told to be quiet. You are not being urged to become reckless, simply to become more aware in your decision-making and to take advantage of good opportunities when they come along. Understand that personal growth is slower while you stay in your comfort zone. Take yourself out of your comfort zone as often as is safe. There's a balance that works best for you. Next, to thine own self be true. It is well known that humans are social creatures by nature. Even the introverts feel the need for social contact. Much of our personality has been shaped by social interaction, the language we speak and the roles we perform in family and community life. There is nothing wrong with this, it is the foundation of healthy communities. The downside is that we can lose sight of who we really are and let our socially defined persona dominate. We must create room for our true nature to express itself. Reward and criticism, these are two sides of the same coin with which society buys our conformity. Become acquainted with your inner self without unduly disturbing the equanimity of your social grouping. You may find yourself withdrawing from groups that place unhealthy emphasis on conformity, the kind of group that shames nonconformity. better to seek the company of non-judgmental people traveling their own conscious path. It takes courage, but we must take full responsibility for who we are and what happens to us. Few things hinder a person's progress more than a lack of honesty with oneself. So, observe your thinking and behavior and ask yourself how much of a straitjacket are you living in? Listen carefully to what your intuition is telling you about people and situations. As you progress along the path, the voice of your intuition becomes stronger because now you are listening to it. The principle of letting the real you emerge is expressed perfectly in Shakespeare's Hamlet, where Polonius gives this most valuable advice to his son. This above all, to thine own self be true, and it must follow, as the night the day, thou canst not then be false to any man. Next, know yourself. It should be getting clearer that extracting yourself from unhealthy social control is a major effort but one that is essential. When we are influenced by the opinions of others, we are allowing them to do our thinking for us. Groupthink is usually at the level of the lowest common denominator of its members. And often, the opinion leaders are themselves not the wisest members but the most persuasive or assertive members. This is the danger in allowing others to do our thinking. Strive to know yourself and to be true to yourself regardless of what others think. You are not looking for trouble, but you are prepared to defy groupthink if it becomes necessary. If the crowd wants to go one way, perhaps at the urging of a charismatic but misguided leader, you choose to be true to yourself. It might make you unpopular at times, but this is your true nature, that which resides under the layers of social conditioning and groupthink. When people disapprove of something you have said or done, it is an instrument of control. Acceptance in a group depends on your conformity to group norms. It is a feature of human group psychology that provided the leader has charisma, others will usually follow. Approval is the other side of the same coin. Behavior that conforms to group expectations is approved of and reinforced. Approval and disapproval together form the standard carrot and stick approach. This mindset is essentially about being an independent thinker. Next, an attitude of simple excellence. There is a Zen saying that when chopping wood, just chop wood, when carrying water, just carry water. Keep your focus on the here and now. Don't allow your mind to wander into the past or future. Slow down your pace and focus intently on that one simple task. Make it your rule to resist doing things fast and easy. Instead, take your time and do them as well as you can. From this mindset comes excellence at everything you do. Zen masters of old were seen taking infinite pains over the smallest, apparently trivial activities, like chopping wood, carrying water. To many, it seems painfully absurd to put so much effort into something that requires only minimal effort to perform. The master is training his mind to be in the now. It can be tremendously rewarding to do everything as well as you possibly can, even the small, seemingly unimportant things. It allows you to extract yourself from the perpetual hurry and raucous noise of modern life and to look at life through the lens of simplicity. The task itself is not as important as the creation of that attitude of excellence. Being excellent is the act of is living up to your human potential. You no longer think that near enough is good enough, that putting only minimal effort into the things you do to save energy is a good way to live. These self-limiting attitudes keep a person firmly in the realm of mediocrity. Next, make peak experiences more likely. Peak experience is a term from 20th century humanistic psychology that equates to Satori and Zen. It is the blissful flash of immersive feeling when subject and object merge and you feel yourself to be one with everything. Peak experiences or Satori are the result of glimpsing your true nature. Until you are fully established in the mindset, the flashes will be brief, intermittent and unpredictable. They will also be memorable and encourages you to continue working towards dwelling in this state of mind. Ridding yourself of your illusions and delusions is important. But first, must find out what your delusions are. This is no easy thing when they hide in plain sight for years and legitimize themselves in all sorts of ways. You will only see them by being brutally honest with yourself. Tough action is needed because delusions are comforting, giving us an out when faced with an uncomfortable truth. It might be surprising to realize just how many delusions people accumulate in a lifetime. But ridding oneself of delusions should not be done with masochistic pleasure. The pain of standing naked and vulnerable in the face of truth can be distressing after one's comforting false beliefs have been stripped away. But do it you must, because truth with a capital T is the foundation of progress on the spiritual path. You cannot make progress without it. How far and how fast you go depends on how comprehensively you embrace the truth and commit to living it when it is easier not to. Nature cannot lie to itself, but humans can. It is the means by which we create a false inner world. By ridding yourself of delusion, your inner world comes into alignment with the outer world, creating harmony between inner and outer worlds. The psychologist Abraham Maslow, best known for his work on the hierarchy of human needs, placed peak experiences at the apex of the hierarchy of needs. When all lower needs had been taken care of, a person will naturally self-actualize or become the fullest expression of their human potential. Peak experiences are therefore a feature of the self-actualizing individual. Maslow described the peak experience as follows. You may notice how closely it corresponds to the descriptions of enlightenment, awakening, Satori, etc. from other traditions. He said this of the peak experience. Feelings of limitless horizons opening up to the vision, the feeling of being simultaneously more powerful and also more helpless than one ever was before, the feeling of ecstasy and wonder and awe, the loss of placement in time and space with, finally, the conviction that something extremely important and valuable had happened, so that the subject was to some extent transformed and strengthened even in his daily life by such experiences. When peak experiences are especially powerful, the sense of self dissolves into an awareness of a greater unity. Next, realistic orientation. Being realistic is the avoidance of wishful thinking, a related idea to the avoidance of delusion. Realism is to look at the world clearly, not through the lens of wishful thinking. It is an efficient perception of reality that applies to all areas of life. You see the truth of situations when others are blind to it. You know what to do and know how to do it, regardless of group pressures. Realistic orientation is the mindset of accepting the world just the way it is. You have rid yourself of crippling guilt, knowing that guilt is a corrosive emotion that undermines your self-esteem and cripples your ability to act, for fear of failure. Ridding yourself of socially conditioned guilt and unnecessary inhibitions allows you to act with integrity and enjoy yourself without regret or apology. Realistic orientation is a form of truth-telling, the truth you tell yourself and then the world. Next, cultivating mindfulness. Much has already been said on this topic, but it is included here for completeness. The term mindfulness has entered into the popular lexicon, having come to represent much more than the term originally meant when it was an aspect of Buddhist meditation and nothing more. We use the term here in the traditional sense of being a meditation practice whose aim is to bring your attention into the here and now, and to systematically activate the higher cognitive functions that you are not necessarily using, becoming more aware of your higher self, and living more of your daily life from this awareness. The human brain is an evolutionary work in progress, truly amazing in its complexity and potential. It is the most recently evolved parts of the brain, the neocortex and frontal lobes, that interest us, as this is where your higher cognitive functions, your higher self, resides. These include your ability for rational thought, creative endeavor, temporal awareness, and the ability to have metacognitive awareness. These are just a few of the higher cognitive functions that nature has blessed us with and which mindfulness can help us unlock. Next, mindfulness as metacognition. Metacognitive awareness is the act of being conscious of being conscious. This is possibly what French philosopher René Descartes was referring to with his famous "I think, therefore I am," quote. I cannot deny the reality of my own consciousness. Bundled into this statement is the egoic I, who has an identity and a life story. Beyond the ego is the metacognitive or higher self that watches what the I is thinking and doing. An example of what our evolved brain allows us to do is our remarkable ability to travel in time. A dog could be the smartest dog in the world, but we still could not say, "Meet me on a particular street corner next Tuesday at noon." We have gone from living in three dimensions to being in a four-dimensional world. Our awareness of the fourth dimension allows us to perceive past, present, and future. With it, we can learn from our mistakes, enjoy the present, and run simulations of possible futures to help us decide. It is mindfulness that helps us moderate this time travel when we overdo it. As we grow even more complex brains, perhaps enhanced by computer technology, it seems likely that we will wake up to higher dimensions of consciousness beyond the fourth. If we think the I is the entirety of who we are, then this new dimension of thought we call metaconsciousness proves otherwise. If the I was in fact the core of who we are, then we would not be able to step outside and see the I from a distance. It is an aspect of our total self, and don't believe it when it tells you that it is the entirety of who you are. This is an example of the kind of intuitive insight a person can have when they do mindfulness meditation, part of a subjective, personal journey to the very core of yourself. That is the journey that the serious Zen practitioner fearlessly embarks upon. It calls for courage because the ego will feel threatened and will try to make you fearful in a multitude of ways designed to lure you away from the spiritual path. Next, sleeper, awake. It can come as a surprise to realize that many people operate at a largely unconscious level, which is to say they are operating on autopilot at the level of habit and instinct, barely aware of what they are doing or why they are doing it. The Zen practitioner does not share this habit. I am not suggesting that people are unconscious in the sense of being asleep. If they are driving a car, or crossing a road, they have enough awareness to avoid catastrophe, at least most of the time. But of course accidents do happen, and are usually the result of a lapse of situational awareness. People can be awake in the sense of not being physically asleep, but unconscious of being locked into conditioned behavior patterns. When a familiar event occurs, it triggers their conditioned reaction to similar events without asking themselves if it is the best course of action. Psychologists call this a stimulus-response pair. Once a connection is established between what happens and how you react, it continues until the person thinks to ask themselves if there might not be a better way to act. It can simply be to think of some other more appropriate way to engage with a situation at the metacognitive level rather than the instinctive or habitual level. Have you noticed how some people seem to make the same mistakes over and over? Bad choices in partners, for example. It is likely that they are operating with insufficient meta-awareness of their conditioned stimulus response. Zen practice is therefore about waking up to awareness of the now, noticing what you are doing and how you are thinking. Then to choose your course of action moment by moment in full awareness of the cause and effect linkages that create the chain of events constituting the flow of your everyday life. You have ultimate control over how you think and feel and act, whether you choose to exercise it or not. This mindset is not unique to Zen. In the Stoic tradition of ancient Greece, a central idea is that while we cannot usually control what people think and do in the outside world, we can indeed control how we think and feel internally. As Stephen Covey puts it in his Seven Habits book, in the space between what happens to you and what you do about it lies your power to choose. Covey was referring to a message from Viktor Frankl's landmark book, Man's Search for Meaning, and the epiphany Frankl experienced while being tortured in a Nazi concentration camp. Regardless of what anyone did to him, he realized in the moment of greatest horror and torment that he always retains the power to decide what his reaction will be. Next, web of cause and effect. In the fully conscious state, you become aware of the web of cause and effect links that determine the course of our lives. That web of connections comes into clear focus and we see that what is happening to us now is the consequence of what we thought and did in the past. And realizing that, we also know that what will happen in the future will be caused by what we do now. This is the true nature of free will, that human faculty that sets us apart from all other creatures. It is our ability to run simulations and consciously decide our actions with an awareness of the consequences, then to choose that which serves our purpose. We play out possible scenarios and see what will end well and what will not. The Zen practitioner knows the truth of this and accepts full responsibility for their life and what happens in it. They consciously perform those actions that they know will bring desirable outcomes. They do not indulge in thinking of themselves as victims of a universe that somehow hates them or of a god that is punishing them. They have created the circumstances of their lives through their choices and the actions they take. They do not lose sight of the web of causality in which they live. The Zen practitioner consciously chooses their actions, moment by moment, in order to create the future that they want for themselves. It gives them that uniquely human privilege of free will, which is the ability to transcend the primitive instincts that still live not very far below the surface of our civilized life. Zen is the key that unlocks the door to a higher, more empowered consciousness in which we have greater control. But with that power necessarily comes responsibility and the obligation to not engage in willfully ignorant practice of blaming others for what we ourselves have caused. Next, you are not your mind. The real you, that which existed before you were born and will continue to exist after you die, is not your egoic mind. This unsettling fact is a fundamental truth that finds expression in many religions and spiritual traditions. Your everyday mind and the thoughts that run through it may seem to be the totality of who you are, but this is far from true. In the microcosmic depths of your being is a greater reality that is a direct reflection of the macrocosm, that which goes far beyond being a person with a name and a position in society. Zen transcends the egoic mindset to make conscious the infinitely larger reality of knowing yourself to be an integrally connected microcosm in a vastly greater reality. You can feel the reality and the truth of this statement. Rumi described this discernment, this awakening, as the sense of being the whole ocean in a drop. The ancient Greeks expressed a similar idea: you are a microcosm of the macrocosm, know thyself and know the universe. Next, if you are not your mind, then who are you? Who indeed are you, if not your mind? By mind I refer to the ego, that sense of being a person with a name living in the world. This sense of personhood and identity occupies a large part of your conscious mind. The message is not to deny or destroy the ego, but to alter your perception and see it in true perspective. If we know why the ego exists, and why it is no longer as critically important to survival as it once was, we can put ego into proper perspective. All living creatures have some degree of awareness of their surroundings, at least enough for their survival and reproduction. This is true even of plants. A tree grows towards the light. Even bacteria know enough to survive and thrive. Humans have highly developed adaptive awareness of their environment. Our species now occupies almost every possible earthly habitat, from baking deserts to the freezing Arctic, something no other species has been able to do. Now we are about to become an interplanetary species with colonies on the Moon, Mars, and orbital space. These achievements point to the remarkable adaptability of the human ego, whose job has always been to think of ways to survive and thrive. The human mind has been shaped by survival imperatives over the past tens of millions of years. There is much that could be said about this, but for the purposes of understanding Zen mindfulness, let us just say that while we might think of ourselves as a person that exists in the world, who has a name, a title, and a place in society, all of that is really no more than a collection of thoughts existing in a transient stream of consciousness with no more reality than the clouds passing overhead on a windy day. They exist but are not as substantial as they appear to be, as anyone knows who has flown through a cloud in an aeroplane. Mindfulness generates objectivity in an otherwise subjective stream of consciousness. As distressing as it might be for the ego to contemplate, our sense of self and the thoughts that pass through our minds are about as substantial as the cloudy water vapor blowing in the wind above our heads. In the microcosm of our inner world, ideas come into awareness, stay for a time, then pass on, making way for the next thought and the next. We are like the crescent-shaped desert sand dune known as a barkan, that advances across the desert over time, pushed by the prevailing wind. The whole dune looks much the same from year to year, but it is not comprised of the same grains of sand. These blow away in the wind and are replaced by more recently arrived grains, brought by the same wind. The barkan presents an illusion of coherence and longevity. We might say the same of hums. Next, befriending your liminal mind. Mindfulness properly practiced reveals that much of what we perceive to be real and permanent is both insubstantial and transient. Mindfulness offers insight into what lies behind the passing parade of thoughts by making conscious the thought activity happening in the liminal mind, which occupies the border zone between our conscious and unconscious minds. It is there because there is a transition, not a sharp divide between the two. You are probably familiar with it from when you are falling asleep, not quite asleep yet, but not fully awake either. From the Latin for threshold, the liminal is a mediator between the conscious and unconscious minds. To access the deep knowledge contained in the unconscious mind, you can pose the question and have the liminal mind pass it to the unconscious mind. The unconscious produces an answer and passes it to the liminal to send on to your conscious mind. There are limitations on what kind of questions can be asked. Obviously, your unconscious mind will not know the outcome of events yet to happen, like the results of next weekend's lotto draw. Example of this happened recently. I was getting ready to harvest the honey from my beehive, something I do once a year in spring. I could not find the uncapping tool needed to open the honeycomb cells and allow the honey to flow out. I spent a long time looking for it without success. So I found a picture of the tool from the eBay site I got it from, went into a meditative state as I looked intently at the picture for half a minute, saying to myself, "Where is this?" 10 minutes later, as I was halfway through having a swim, my liminal mind pushed an image into my consciousness of a cranny in my tool room. Sure enough, it was hanging there. My unconscious knew where the honey scraper was because it remembered when I put it there. It is important to be super clear about the question when asking your unconscious mind via the liminal to find answers to questions. Vaguely worded questions will produce unclear answers or no answers. Finding lost objects is one thing, but getting answers to the questions that confront you on the spiritual path is far more significant. Liminal remembering is extremely useful. It gives you access to the storehouse of knowledge and perhaps wisdom contained in your deeper self. Remember, Zen is about uncovering your true nature, which is another way of saying deeper self. Next, being in the flow state. When you are so engrossed in the present moment that you lose track of time, you are experiencing every moment as the best moment. This is sometimes called a state of flow after the work of Hungarian-American psychologist Mihaly Csikszentmihalyi. The flow state of mind is a learnable skill. It is an action-oriented state that requires you to be engaged in an activity with the following conditions. Have a clearly understood goal for the accomplishment of a task. The goal must allow you to find the right balance between how difficult or challenging the task is, and how much skill is needed to successfully accomplish it, and there must be a way for you to get immediate feedback on what you are doing, which allows you to make ongoing adjustments to your approach. Balancing the level of challenge with your skill level is vital. Too little challenge for a highly skilled person creates a mood of boredom. When the challenge is high, but skill is low, you will feel anxiety. Low challenge coupled with low skill creates apathy, which is the opposite of flow. But when challenge and skill are both high and evenly matched, the conditions are right for the flow state to spontaneously occur. Here is a more detailed list of how to create the right conditions for flow, attributed to Csikszentmihalyi. They have been found to be true for people everywhere, regardless of culture, education, or other differences. Be completely involved in what you are doing, with a high degree of sustained concentration. It is not enough to be intelligent and in possession of skills, unless you can deploy those skills in a disciplined way for long enough to get the job done. You must have the ability to concentrate for long periods. A sense of ecstasy and happiness, when the rest of the world fades into the background. Sometimes it completely disappears. This includes your sense of self, the person you are. You stop noticing that you even have a self. Great inner clarity in which you see what needs to be done in detail, plus how well you are going with the task of creating it. When you create a clear image of your goal in your inner world, the more likely it can be realized in the outer world. Knowing that the task is achievable, that your skills are enough to get the job done. A sense of serenity in which you cease to worry about yourself. You have a feeling of having grown beyond the boundaries of your own ego. Timelessness, in which hours can pass but seem to be only minutes. Intrinsic motivation, the activity is its own reward. You feel the task is worth doing for its own sake. You would do it whether you got paid or not, because you love doing it. In addition to the conditions outlined by Csikszentmihalyi, later work suggests that these factors also contribute to the creation of flow. Feedback: as you perform the task, you receive direct and immediate feedback on what you are doing, which enables you to make micro adjustments, moment by moment, to improve the process. Balance between challenge and skill: you have a sense that your abilities are matched to the task at hand, neither too easy nor too difficult. Control: you feel in complete control of the situation, a sense of mastery. Gradually, you can extend this practice from being absorbed in the things you really enjoy to the more mundane things that you might previously been bored with. The key is to find satisfaction in doing one thing at a time with allowing your mind to jump here and there from idea to idea.
It is not so much what you are doing, but how you are doing it that matters. Action exercise. Using metacognition, observe the activity of your mind for an hour or two. The watcher simply watches, it does not judge or interfere, just observes the flow of consciousness. Simply observe the train of thought, the stream of consciousness.
At the end of the period, notice how much time you spent in either past or future musings.
It is likely to be more than half the time.
Mindfulness, or present moment focus, is a foundational aspect of Zen. You must discipline your mind to focus almost exclusively on the present moment, gently returning your attention to the present every time it wanders. The exception is when you have need for practical reasons to recall the past and make plans for the future. The key is to do it no more than is actually necessary. The kind of present moment awareness that you are aiming for is illustrated by this example. Imagine you are walking along a city street. Without warning, someone appears. They are running very fast and coming straight towards you on a collision course.
How present focused are you now?
This is the kind of intense present moment awareness that needs to be cultivated and maintained all the time, not just when self-preservation is the priority.
I use this example because it is an actual experience.
Walking within every moment is the best moment mindset. Along a busy sidewalk on Market Street in San Francisco one sunny July morning, a young man came barreling towards me. He was thin and agile, and running as fast as he could go, weaving skillfully around the people in his way.
But there was no avoiding me. I had about a second to brace for impact. Had I not been fully in the moment already, he would have knocked me over.
As it was, I had just enough time to turn and lean my shoulder towards him like a rugby player. He struck me a hard glancing blow, and continued on, with little loss of speed. He looked back, smiled and yelled sorry.
That's San Francisco for you.
Having an every moment is the best moment mindset not only helps you to enjoy life, it gives you the presence of mind to react well in emergencies. It has saved my life at least twice and spared me from harm on countless other occasions.
Next, non-attachment.
The first of the four noble truths of Buddhism hold that people experience suffering because they are attached to the temporary things of this world which must inevitably disappear. This is the root cause of all human suffering, so there is much to be gained from mastering non-attachment.
This principle applies to the physical and non-physical aspects of our lives.
Attachment to our identity is perhaps the strongest attachment of all. It explains why the fear of death is so powerful. The ego knows that when death comes, it will be extinguished like the candles on a birthday cake.
The fear of extinction transcends all fears.
The remedy is to transcend the ego and perceive the greater reality of your whole being, of the which the ego is a component, albeit a noisy one.
Egoic attachment is also the root of many arguments. When a person devoutly believes something, that belief is part of their identity, their sense of self. Little wonder then that they will defend that belief strenuously. It has become a matter of survival.
Other examples of what we are attached to include the various social structures and networks that we belong to. We can be addicted to sex, to a whole range of pleasurable drugs, to games of chance, thrill-seeking and all the various vices so eloquently prescribed in religion. We can be super attached to people and the relationships we have with them.
The foods we like to eat.
There are hundreds if not thousands of worldly things that we are attached to without even realizing it until they are suddenly no longer there.
This would be the origin of the old truism that you don't know what you've got till it's gone. People are attached to the past.
It makes them nostalgic and inclined to try to recreate the good times, to relive their glory days even though they are probably looking at those days through rose-colored glasses.
We must let go of the past whether it was good or bad. If it was good, it can fill us with nostalgic longing for a time that can never return. If it was bad, it can haunt us with pain and regret.
Either way, we must free ourselves from it. Recognize that whatever is contained in the now is enough, and needs nothing more for it to be perfect, for it to be the best moment of your life. Non-attachment is also about resisting the temptation to define yourself by your possessions or your role in society, including any titles you might have.
You are much more than those.
If you had a sudden reversal of fortune and lost all your possessions and reputation, the essential you will still be real and unchanged. For the person with many attachments, such a loss would be completely devastating, perhaps leading to suicidal depression in some cases. Yet all such material possessions and egoic structures are destined to disappear one day anyway.
What is left after all your worldly possessions are gone is who you truly are and have always been. I am not suggesting that you should take an ascetic vow of poverty or give your possessions away. Enjoy them, but know how much is enough and refuse to allow your possessions to define you. How will you know when you have succeeded at this? You will know when you no longer wonder who you would be if you lost everything.
If a tornado takes your house and your livelihood, and you are standing on the bare concrete foundations being interviewed by local news media, you can still say, "Well, I'm still alive and I'm thankful for that."
Next, the need for approval.
Non-attachment is freeing yourself from the need to have people approve of you. Most of us crave social acceptance, and when we don't get it, we become depressed and will go to great lengths to regain it. Free yourself from the upset of knowing that sometimes people won't like you or like what they think you stand for. Maybe you just remind them of someone they've had problems with in the past, nothing to do with you. Approval and disapproval, praise and criticism are two sides of the same coin with which people buy our compliance. They are often used together as the carrot and stick or great jackass theory of motivation. Most people are familiar with it from early childhood onwards as a standard parenting and schooling technique.
Next, codependency.
Non-attachment is being able to ask yourself difficult questions and being able to answer honestly. Do you depend on someone or something for your happiness? If you do, that person or thing is sure to disappoint you sooner or later.
How can they not?
They are only human, and they won't always be there.
Healthy relationships are those in which the parties are not dependent on each other to the point where they will manipulate the other to ensure they continue to get what they need from them.
Instead, they are independent people who choose to spend time together for the enjoyment it brings, not because of addictive craving or sense of obligation. Sadly, for some, the romantic image of a soulmate that completes me is not a healthy one because it defines you as incomplete.
Deep down, you are complete.
It is only your ego that has convinced you otherwise. Your true self, deep down, is a whole person who needs no completing.
You should examine closely any relationship that does not allow you to be a whole person.
Arguably, a healthy relationship is one in which you help each other become a better person, a fuller expression of your unique human potential.
This is the basis of a happy and enduring marriage, and of true friendship.
This is not incompatible with non-attachment, because you will be able to let go when the time comes to let go, and not before.
Next, chain of cause and effect.
Mindfulness raises your awareness to the point where it becomes possible to consciously engineer the life you want for yourself. You are able to perceive the cause and effect linkages between what you did in the past that created the conditions of your life today, and also what you need to do today to create the conditions you want tomorrow. Your life becomes purposeful, less chaotic. You take responsibility for what happens in your life.
This is the real meaning of free will.
Your heightened awareness gives you the ability to make choices that are informed by a conscious awareness of the likely consequences of your actions.
Next, mindfulness and past hurt.
Mindfulness can be an effective therapy for post-traumatic stress disorder. With PTSD, memories of past trauma are triggered and replayed endlessly in the sufferer's mind. Their body responds as though the events are happening here and now by producing an adrenaline-fueled fight or flight response.
When this happens over and over, the sufferer becomes stressed and exhausted.
Many sufferers self-medicate the pain away, often with readily available alcohol, which leads to further problems with addiction and health-eroding side effects.
It has all the makings of a downward spiral.
If you have PTSD or you struggle with the memory of traumatic past events, then mindfulness can be very helpful. By withdrawing your attention from the past and focusing on the present, you break the cycle of reliving those painful events over and over. The key is to keep your attention on the present and pay no attention to those intrusive thoughts. Every time the painful memory comes in awareness, dismiss it and focus attention on the present moment. What you pay attention to gets stronger, so if you are not feeding the past through giving it attention, it starves and eventually withers away, or at least ceases to have enough force to disturb you.
it may take weeks and months to retrain your mind to refocus attention on the now moment. While it is not easy in the beginning, it is not too long before you are noticing improvements. Such a simple idea, and so effective.
Practicing mindfulness frees you to recreate your sense of identity as a strong, present-focused person.
The new identity replaces the old, dysfunctional identity. Next, the experience of Satori.
Satori moments, or flashes of awakening, can occur when your inner world comes into harmony with the outer world, becoming one, dissolving the ego for a time.
Flashes of Satori can occur anytime, any place. I offer this example from my own life.
I decided to adopt an attitude of appreciating the many small things around me that I had been taking for granted. To many people, these things are just so ordinary, small and commonplace that they are not worthy of notice.
But in their way, these small things can be beautiful and perfect. It is a matter of scale. If we were as small, we would notice.
And small things have quite a story to tell if we bother to slow down and look with a childlike open mind. Even the most commonplace objects have a gift for us if only we would take the time to notice. One day I noticed the moss growing in the cracks between the paving stones on the path along the service road from the car park to my office at Griffith University's Nathan campus.
Moss is a common sight in shady places. At first glance, there is nothing remarkable.
Just one of many objects passing by our line of sight every day. But when you get down for a close look, there is something beautiful about moss, this modest survivor that has been around for the past 500 million years. So, I got down on my hands and knees and looked closely.
What I saw filled me with wonder. To think that moss like this had existed for so long.
I tried to stretch my imagination across such a vast span of time.
This was the cone, to contemplate the humble moss plant. Then, having stretched my imagination so far into the past, I now tried to imagine the future by the same amount. The now moment became the fulcrum of a billion-year span. This unassuming little plant took on a big new meaning.
For the moss plant, there is only ever the now moment regardless of how much time lies behind or before it.
Unlike the moss, we humans will not survive a billion years in our current form.
And when our species has morphed into something else or become extinct, the moss will still be modestly growing in the shaded damp places. This one little moss plant inspired a human to think such thoughts. What about the countless others growing in deep forests, never seen by humans?
It reminded me of a poem by Thomas Gray that I learned in school.
Full many a flower is born to blush unseen,
and waste its sweetness on the desert air.
This train of thought, I realized, was a continuation of one which began decades earlier on a hiking holiday in New Zealand. The terrain in the southern fjord lands of NZ was formed by the scouring glaciers of successive ice ages, the latest being around 8,000 years ago. It is surely some of the most beautiful terrain anywhere in the world, not unlike Norway.
The trees in this rainforest are tall and moss-covered, dripping with moisture. Soft light comes through the canopy, giving it all a transcendent beauty. It was so quiet I could hear birdsong from hundreds of meters away.
Moss covered every inch of the forest floor, in some places a meter thick. It was like walking on a mattress, but one which exhaled a welcoming earthy breath with every step.
I felt such love and reverence for that moss-covered forest.
My ego dissolved, I was one with the forest, feeling infinitely connected.
I lay down on the mossy bed and felt my essence merge with the forest.
I remember thinking that if this is what dying is like, I have lost all fear. In Satori moments like that, the ego dissolves and a new, infinitely more wonderful reality dawns. 40 years later, the memory is still so vivid it gives me goosebumps on my scalp.
That concludes our discussion of the Zen mindset.
For more information, see the video description.
Thank you.